Talal, I'll move on to you. Sorry for keeping you waiting for so long, like everyone else. Just a quick one. I mean, how do you see budget supporting entrepreneurs? There were some emphasis, I think, earlier also. One of the panelists did mention about there's sort of focus on improving livelihood. I'm talking about entrepreneurship, particularly startups, and how do you see that this budget facilitating that challenge?
Thank you, Nesta, and thanks for having me. Talking about how it helps, let me just get 2 points out. So one is, in Sri Lanka, we have an extremely low rate of entrepreneurs, 3%, which is low compared to other countries. Like Bangladesh, it's 12%. And the other thing is, with a lot of disruptive innovation happening, a lot of the private sector, which accounts for 80% of the GDP, which is a creation of entrepreneurs, could... especially like in the coming decades could go off. So we need entrepreneurs who want to scale up to bring up companies to replace this. And going on to the budget, let me talk about, there are a number of positives as well. Removing the business registration fee for startups, that's a good move. And having a single window for importing, exporting could help, and establishment of the mini supermarket networks and investment zones for new products such as organic fertilizer, pharmaceutical production, and production of raw materials for the apparel industry. And also agro parks being built on uncultivated land. As we know that Sri Lanka, the government owns a very high percentage of land compared to the rest of the region. So there are a few shortfalls as well. Some things that I feel recommendations could have been done. Like, let's face it, it's a tough year for the government, so with such a big fiscal deficit. But on the policy side, some things could have been done. How I would say is like things I would like to have. For example, on the ease of doing business, we need to move a bit up because we are 99th in the world. And young businesses or startups or SMEs don't have the luxury of the larger companies. Like they have full-time lawyers, an HR department, accountants. So when you're starting, time is very valuable. So a one-stop place like how the BOI does for larger companies, that could be this thing. But as Sanjay said, you know, different businesses, industries require different things. But I'm talking about at the basic level, things, sort of things that could be done. Yeah, one place for that, that'll be good. And also when you look at the World Bank's ease of doing business, New Zealand tops the list. There are two interesting things. One is that, for example, in New Zealand, registering a company takes half a day. And also most of the information is just very simple to find. So that's this thing. And one other thing I want to say is that we need to have a sort of a separate framework for registering, like forming or closing businesses for startups, because not many people talk about this. And even with my experience, the first company or even the second company an entrepreneur registers is not a success. And as we know, registering a company is very easy, but and a shorter process. But closing down a company is a much longer process. So many people say that, you know, they open a company for one investment from one country, but then it doesn't work out. And the next investor doesn't want to use that company. He wants a new company. So shutting down that company is a longer process. So that would kind of encourage more people to move in the formal direction. And as I mentioned, my last thing as well, we have a very shortfall of STEM graduates coming out, only 4,000 a year. So when you look at India, it's 2.6 million. So even per million, it comes up to around 8 times more. So we need to have more of those, because out of the 5,000 we produce, 1,000 leave the country. That's one thing. And also, lastly, like one thing is that our economy is small. So, and as with only just $4,000 GDP per capita, as well as a 22 million population, we need to kind of position ourselves as a launching pad. So Vietnam has 26 FTAs, Sri Lanka only has around 3. So more FTAs would encourage investment to come, because when you compare to 2010 and right now, there's much more foreign investment coming in. So there's an opportunity in this area as well. And lastly, we need to encourage or work on companies to scale up. So currently I work with NASDAQ on advising and mentoring some Silicon Valley startups as well. One thing I noticed, the difference is that there it's always about growth, always about scaling up. So they look at the market as the whole world. So these are a few things that I would have thought I would have focused on. Yeah.
Thanks, Talal.